Let us redraw it again. Now suppose your material is not 0.8% carbon steel or eutectoid. Say this is the material is having a composition somewhere here. So in this side it is called hypoeutectoid, and on this side it is called hyper-eutectoid. So here it is eutectoid composition. So if you have hypo-eutectoids, you know, say steel, hypo-eutectoid steel. Now how would the TTT diagram look like? This is a question. So if you have a hypoeutectoid steel, what will happen? Suppose you have a gamma phase here. The moment you come to this temperature, you will get a alpha plus, you will enter in this alpha plus gamma region. So you will have alpha in your gamma phase. As you cool down your the material, your carbon percentage in alpha will increase and you will go here. And then once you reach this temperature, below that you will get alpha plus perlite, because alpha was already nucleated, alpha will be there. And then when the gamma reaches to this composition, because percentage of carbon in gamma will be increasing and it will reach the eutectoid composition, then on further cooling this will undergo a, you know, eutectoid transformation, gamma to alpha plus Fe3C. So this composition has 0.02% carbon, here 6.67% carbon. So this lamellar structure you will have. So now how will you explain this thing in the TTT diagram? So in TTT diagram, if it is here in this side, you will have a curve like this, that you already know. Now say this is, say, MS. And say this is MF. This is martensite. Here you will have gamma plus martensite. And what will be this temperature? Now this temperature is a eutectoid temperature. We are talking about hypoeutectoid steel. So hypoeutectoid steel, if you have gamma here, before gamma gives you, say, perlite plus gamma or perlite, here you have bainite plus gamma, so here you have bainite. What will it give you? It will precipitate out the alpha from the gamma. So, and at what temperature? A3. So this is A3, this is A1. A3 temperature will vary depending on the composition. If this is the composition, this will be the temperature. So this is A3 temperature. This T is the A1 temperature. So now you will have a region where it will go like this, parallel. So here what will you get? You will get alpha plus gamma. So here you will get alpha plus gamma, and if your undercooling is below that, you will get perlite plus gamma. But now alpha, which was already there, it will also be there. It will also be there. So here also you will get alpha plus perlite, because this alpha will remain. You know? So alpha will remain. So everything else will be same, similar. But this time, the minimum time. What will happen to this time? The minimum time required for nucleation. Here you are moving carbon percentage is less compared to this 0.8% still. Here the carbon percentage is less. So this is here this diagram is say 0.4% carbon. So in that case, whether this curve will be moved to the left or right, or it will remain as it is. You see, nucleation, this represents the time required for nucleation of perlite. So the time required for nucleation of perlite, as we have studied, if there is second phase in the material, the nucleation becomes easier. Or second phase means it can be some particle which helps in nucleation. So if you have some nucleation sites, then the nucleation will be easier and the time for nucleation will be reduced. Now here what happened? Say if your carbon percentage is less, say here from the Leber rule, what can we say? That this length by total, say percentage of alpha will be here at this temperature T factor 0.8 minus C by 0.8 minus 0.02. So this much of fraction of alpha, so this is fraction of alpha ferrite is already there before the pyrolytic transformation start. Alpha is already nucleated. So now the question is whether this for high p-eutectoid steel, whether this curve will be moved to left or right, or it will remain same. If you see, whenever we have nucleation site in the material, then the nucleation rate or nucleation becomes easier, the nucleation rate will be faster. This is what we know for, this is called heterogeneous nucleation. So in case of hypo-eutectoid steel, carbon percentage is less. So as the carbon percentage is less than the eutectoid steel, what will happen? Before pyrolytic transformation start, you will already have some alpha, that is ferrite. And ferrite is a cubic structure. So when ferrite is a cubic structure, ferrite is there. Perlite is also alternate layers of ferrite and cementite. So nucleation of ferrite will help in the nucleation of perlite. So the nucleation rate will be easier actually. This curve will actually here the time will be around 0.2 second, or actually it will be less than 1. Say many times less than earlier, which we said 1 second it requires for 0.8%. Here it will be much less, say 0.234, something like that, but it will be many times less than the eutectoid, because again I am repeating, if your carbon percentage is less than the eutectoid composition, ferrite will precipitate out, and this ferrite, alpha ferrite, will act as nucleation site for nucleation of perlite. So the nucleation will be easier. As the nucleation will be easier, then the nucleation rate will be faster. So this nucleation time will reduce. So this curve will be shifted to this side. Now if you have the opposite scenario, what will happen? Say you have some alloying elements in the system, which will say this transformation is assisted by diffusion, we said, no? Here undercooling is left, so it is diffusion assisted. Diffusion assisted. Here also it is diffusion assisted. So if it is diffusion assisted, if somehow you can resist the diffusion, then time for nucleation will increase and the carb will be moved to that side. So when you have some alloying elements present in the material, you know, alloying elements means these are not precipitate, these are part of the material. Say they are substitutional elements or interstitial elements. What will happen? Those elements will resist the diffusion. Presence of any alloying elements generally, in general, resist the diffusion. As a result, the nucleation will be difficult. So, the carb will be moved to the right. So, this kind of movement, sometimes if you have some carbide precipitates, say cementite, Fe3C. Well, Fe3C means if you increase the carbon percentage, Fe3C becomes, the formation of cementite becomes easier. Now once a cementite is formed, that will act as a nucleation site and it will, you know, accelerate the nucleation rate. So the carb will be moved to the right. But after this 0.8% of, you know, carbon, generally this movement is very, very minimum because the amount of cementite, you know, is very less. We are not going into that, but anyway, in general, you should remember that when this curve moves right, what happens? You get a big window for reaching the martensitic transformation. That means if your start curve is here, suppose, if it moves from here to here, now you can have a higher cooling rate, still you can get the martensite. Otherwise, earlier you had to, you know, give a very fast cooling rate so that you don't touch this starting time in order to get the martensite. So, if you add some alloying elements which will move this curve to the right, you get a bigger window for making your material more hard by transforming it into martensite. So the hardenability increases by shifting this curve to the C plots to the right. Similarly, you can, if you go to the left, it decreases. This is the critical, you know, rate correspond to this nose, actually this time, which tells you this is the critical rate for transformation of martensite. So there is always a critical rate. Your cooling rate has to be faster than this, then only you get martensite. So let us draw the eutectoid one. 0.8%. So this is a one. So now you see, you get perlite here, also perlite, and bainite here, also bainite, coarse, fine. This is also coarse fine, it is called upper, called lower. Martensite, martensitic start, martensitic finish. So here we call it only martensite. So here you have gamma, here you have gamma metastable. Here you have gamma plus P, B plus P. So you see, now if you want to do a particular retreatment, you see you have so many possibilities. If you do a undercooling of this much and then hold it for different amounts of time, so if you hold it for this amount of time, you will get some perlite and the retained austenite will be there. Now if you cool it up to this much, then you hold it, you see, you will get some bainite, then again you quench it, then you will get some martensite. So you get perlite, you know, by night, Martin said, if you quench it directly from here, what will you get? Perlite plus martensite. So, and you can vary the amount of perlite and martensite you want. If you want, say, if you do a cooling like this, go there, you got some bainite, then come here, you get bainite plus martensite. So, there are different possibilities actually you can get. But in industry, it is not done like this. In industry, what is done? The cooling rate is generally continuous. It is logs, you know, and the x-axis is in log scale. So it looks, you know, like curved line, but actually cooling rate is constant on this line. So what happens in industry, the transformation is never isothermal. In that case, what happens? The temperature cooling is continuous. The rate can be constant, or it is very difficult to maintain the cooling rate, because if you have a big specimen, you cannot maintain the temperature to be constant throughout the thickness if you have a big or thick specimen. But if your conductivity is very high, maybe the variation will be less, but there will be some gradient from surface to the center. So the cooling is, the transformation is hardly isothermal. So what happens? The transformation starts at some temperature and ends at another temperature. So you end up getting a transformation like this. So in that case, this TTT diagram is not very useful. We need to use the CCT diagram. So let us now discuss the CCT diagram. So the CCT diagram is like what we did for TTT diagram. It can be obtained in a similar way. Here only the thing is that you take a specimen . Say this is, say, A1 line. A1 means eutectoid line. So you have a gamma here at this temperature. Now this is time on log scale, and this is temperature, say degree centigrade. So we are discussing about now CCT diagram. So in CCT diagram, how do we get the CCT diagram? Say, let us say, you know, keep the drawing of the TTT diagram like this. This is the martensitic start. So this is martensitic finish, MS, MF. This is the start. This is the finishing line. So what happened? The cooling is, unlike earlier, it will be continuous. So although these curves, you know, these are temperature versus time variation. These are temperature versus time variation curve. So in log scale, it may look like, you know, curve, but dT cooling rate is constant for each of this curve. So per unit time, the change in temperature is constant. So when you have continuous cooling curve for different cooling rates, you see, here, now, suppose this is a particular cooling rate, and you track the volume fraction change. Say how much pyrolite is being formed with time. At this temperature, this is the starting time and this is the finishing time. So if you come down, you will get a point here. You will get a point here. So this is a volume fraction goes from 0 to 1 with time. So here you have the endpoint. So you will have a S curve like this. And here you will get at this temperature, you increase the cooling rate. You see, cooling rate is increasing because in less time you are dropping more temperature. Now, and this is say somewhere here it is the finishing time, somewhere here it is the start time. You get another curve like this. So this is T1, T2, T3, T4, T5, T6, like this. One thing you should notice, although I have marked the starting point here, but actually this is just to, you know, make you realize when the transformation is not isothermal, actually this takes, the nucleation takes more time. Actually the nucleation will be happening somewhere, you know, here. It requires more time because now the cooling is continuous. So the material, it is not isothermal. You are not holding it at a constant temperature. To come to this temperature, you don't come directly to this temperature. So the material is effectively, you know, at high temperature for more times. So if your material is at high temperature for more time, what will happen? The driving force delta GV is less because undercooling is less. So that is why the nucleation will be, you know, delayed. The nucleation rate will be less because driving force is less. So in this case it will take more time. So actually the nucleation rate will be not here, but it will be here. All the cases the nucleation will take more time, and then you will get a curve like this, which will be little bit shifted. Say for say this is another undercooling. Say this is the nose, the maximum you can get, the maximum nucleation rate that you can get, or the minimum time that you require. Similarly, the finishing time also will be more. Here say it is intersecting with this, just assuming. Now if you realize, in case of continuous cooling, you need more time for nucleation, you need more time for completion also of the transformation. So this time is actually starting time, and this is the second one. This will be the finishing time. Starting time. This will be the finishing time. For CCT diagram, this is how actually for different rates of cooling you get where the transformation starts and where it ends. And where it ends, you get a point. Where it starts, you get a point. You join this starting point, you join all the ending points, you get the CCT curve. Now in CCT, you know, diagram, you see, you don't get any, only you get pyrolite, coarse and fine. Actually in CCT diagram, continuous cooling, it is not possible to get binite in this region. Binite takes long time. Moreover, you see, if your cooling is continuous, you cannot achieve this binite without nucleating perlite. Moreover, it is not, actually the main reason is that you cannot get bainite in continuous cooling curve because the line moves, the bainitic region moves a lot to the right. So it is not in the same region. So here you will have gamma, here you have gamma unstable, here you will have gamma plus perlite, perlite fine and perlite coarse and perlite fine, you will have martensite. So there will be some threshold cooling rate. This one is the one, this is the other one. So generally for eutectoid steel, you know, this threshold undercooling is about, here it is about 35 degrees Celsius per second, and here at about 140 degrees centigrade per second. So if you want to get martensite, your cooling rate has to be more than 140 degrees centigrade per second. That is the cooling rate you require to get martensite. And for completion of, you know, if you want to get perlite, cooling rate has to be less than 35 degree centigrade, then only you get, you know, full perlite. Otherwise you will not get full perlite. You can now, if you say, if you come here and then quench, or if you go like this, you will get some perlite, then the rest will be martensite. So you will get perlite plus martensitic structure. There will be, you know, it is in this region, you will have perlite plus gamma, and here this remaining austenite will be transformed into perlite, sorry, martensite. So this kind of transformation is possible. So if you now, so CCT and TTT diagrams are similar, only this one thing you have to remember, that in CCT diagram you don't get the bainitic region. Bainitic region is very difficult. You get very small amount of bainite, it is very difficult to get. Now if you have a hyper eutectoid steel, suppose you are here, then how would the TTT diagram look like? Please note that we are again discussing about TTT diagram, not CCT. The curve will be similar. No? Only the thing is that now you will have, here in this region you will have Fe3 cementite plus, you know, here you will have this region gamma, here you will have gamma plus perlite plus this cementite will be there, Fe3C. Ever this nose will have Fe3C plus cementite will be there, because cementite is nucleated here. Here it is all gamma, not here. This temperature will be a CM. This will be this temperature, austenite and cemented boundary. Austenite, and actually this is not cemented, cemented plus austenite. So here you have all gamma above, here gamma metastable. There you have, you know, bainite. There you have gamma plus bainite perlite. Then you will have martensite start, martensite finish, MS, MF. Here all martensite, here martensite plus martensite gamma, you can get martensite plus gamma. So this kind of phases you will get. So now also you have got different opportunities, you know, to get different types of, different combination of phases. So this is the importance of, you know, the phase diagram, or say this is the importance of
the TTT diagram and CCT diagram, how you can get different types of phases in parenchyma enamel. So now I think after this brief introduction about this CCT and TTT diagram, now we will see how the different phases are needed. You see, now we will see how you get parlite, how you get binite, or what are the different phases and what are the different morphologies and the related kinetics and thermodynamics of the transformation. These things now we will be discussing. So for all these things, you can read any textbook, you will find all these things, very basic things. But especially you can follow the book by V. Raghavan, Physical Metallurgy, some part of the book, not everything.